Good evening. Picture yourself in January 1901. My great-grandfather's first automaking venture, the Detroit Automobile Company, was dissolved. Henry Ford wanted to build cars. His investors wanted him to make delivery trucks, and they wanted him to use a design that was complicated, impractical, and unreliable. Nobody wanted a delivery truck in 1901. And so after losing $86,000 and building just 20 delivery trucks, the Detroit Automobile Company slipped quietly out of business. It was a crushing defeat for my great-grandfather. He was 38 years old and he was broke. To make ends meet, he moved in with his family. His wife Clara and their son Edsel moved in with their father, William Ford. His father, by the way, had always insisted that young Henry was always a dreamer and should have stuck with farming. So you can imagine what the evenings were probably like around the dinner table. Henry Ford's backers in his short-lived auto company had included the mayor of Detroit, a United States senator, and a wealthy financier, none of whom were apt to throw any more money his way. If he wanted to start another car company, and he did, then he needed to find a fresh source of capital. He needed to put himself back in the public eye. To do that, he turned to racing. He knew that racing grabbed the public imagination, and it just so happened that one of the biggest races in the country was being planned practically in Henry Ford's backyard. On October 10th, 1901, the Detroit Driving Club was hosting a national advertised 25-lap race at the Grosse Pointe Blue Ribbon horse racing track. The icing on the cake was that Alexander Winton, motor racing's first American superstar, would be entering the race. Winton was everything Henry Ford had hoped he would be. He was a successful automaker, and his Winton motor carriages were the best-selling gasoline-fueled passenger cars in America. They were also the most prestigious. After all, the Vanderbilts drove Wintons. Winton was also a bit of a dilettante. When Winton's sales manager was approached about the Detroit race, he said that Mr. Winton was less than enthusiastic. The grand prize of $1,000 was a small fortune in its day, but not enough to guarantee the presence of America's greatest driver. Finally, Winton's manager struck a deal. Mr. Winton would only participate if he got to pick out the trophy ahead of time. The driving club agreed, and Winton selected a magnificent cut glass punch bowl, which he thought would look just perfect in the bay windows of his elegant Cleveland home. The punch bowl. With Winton signed on to win the race, the success of the event was guaranteed. All the financial elite of Detroit would be in the stands. The courthouse would even be closed for the day so the lawyers could attend. Henry Ford realized that if he could put up a good show in front of such a prosperous crowd, he might just have the chance of getting back into the auto business. So with just a few months in which to do it, my great-grandfather assembled a small team and built a car. It stood high off the ground on 28-inch wheels and looked like a cross between an oversized baby carriage and a small grand piano. As you can see in the photograph, there was no windshield, and its driver was exposed to the elements from the ankles on up. I remind you, the race was October 10th, 1901, not a warm time in Detroit. No matter what angle you viewed it from, it looked half finished. But it had an elegant name. They called it sweepstakes. The salad course, please feel free to pick it up as you want to and serve the main course. Being a mechanical engineer, Henry Ford concentrated on the powertrain. The engine had only two cylinders, but a displacement of 538 cubic inches. That's 180 inches more than one NASCAR approves today. It used a complicated form of mechanical fuel injection known as a vaporizer. But despite those impressive specs, it produced a mere 26 horsepower. Henry Ford was fine with that. After all, what he was looking for was reliability. The Achilles heel of engines of that day was usually ignition. And Henry Ford had designed his system around a new form of spark coil using an insulator built to his specifications by a local dentist. And it was made from denture ceramic. It really was the precursor of the modern day spark plug. I don't think it was my great-grandfather's intention to ever win this race. He couldn't afford to hire anyone, so he had to drive his own car. He had never raced before, and he was up against the greatest driver in the country. Winning under those conditions would be unthinkable. It would be like a rookie driver today winning the Daytona 500 the day after his 20th birthday. For those of you who watched it on television, you have no idea. I was there. I watched the whole thing from the Wood Brothers pit box. It was the single most exciting race that I've been at in many, many years. And Trevor Bayne's one great driver, and we've got some new sponsorship for him, so I'm wandering a little bit from the text. But he has been a breath of fresh air to the Ford Racing Program, a breath of fresh air to the Wood Brothers, and more importantly, NASCAR has told me personally that he's now attracting a much younger audience to NASCAR, and that's exactly what they want. Well, back to the script. When the day of the great race came, 8,000 spectators packed the grandstands and lined the fences of the track. 13 teams were entered from Detroit alone, but the star of the field was Alexander Winton. He had brought his best car, powered by a 70 horsepower engine. The promoters had planned a full day of racing, but by the time the main event had come around, only Winton, my great-grandfather, and one other competitor were running well enough to drive under their own power to the starting line. In addition, the driving club decided at the last minute to change the format of the race. They had originally planned a 25-lap endurance race, but told the competitors, Mr. Ford and Mr. Winton and the other driver, it was going to be a 10-lap sprint race. The starting gun was fired, and Winton, as expected, took an early lead. But then sweepstakes, while less powerful, was also considerably lighter than its competitors. It began to catch up. By the seventh lap, Henry Ford was hot on Alex and Winton's tail. And then on the eighth lap, it happened. Winton's car began to sputter and misfire. As the pair came off the fourth turn and hurtled down the front straight, Henry Ford made the pass and put Alexander Winton in his dust. It was a thrilling moment. It was, I promise you, an historic moment. A moment that identified Henry Ford as a winner worth watching. and it scared the living daylights out of my great-grandfather. After he drove into the winner's circle, a great crowd of spectators crowded him and shouted to him that they were willing to back him in any venture that involved wheels. The first words out of his mouth were, "Never again." The promoters presented him with his $1,000 check, and then they brought out the trophy and handed him the elegant cut glass punch bowl. Now, I want you just for a minute to picture that moment. We have all seen winner's circles on television, and many of us have actually been in them. Henry Ford looked at that bowl in his hands, and he knew the story behind it and knew how much Alexander Winton desired that punch bowl. The man had picked it out specifically for a place of honor in his big house in Cleveland. And Winton was standing right next to Henry Ford watching the ceremonies. So knowing how much the very beautiful punch bowl meant to Alexander Winton, my great-grandfather did what any racing professional worth his salt would do. He took it home. And smiled at it for the next 46 years. Now, for the second part of the story, you have to understand that my great-grandfather never was very much for record-keeping. If something was important to him, he didn't write it down. He just remembered it. My great-grandfather passed away in 1947, and my great-grandmother followed him 3 years later. When the grandchildren dealt with the estate, nobody recognized the significance of the punch bowl. They thought it was just a quaint old antique. Besides, everyone in the family already owned a punch bowl. And frankly, it's just not the sort of thing you need two of. And so on October 17th, 1951, 50 years later, in 1 week, after Henry Ford brought it home following the race that literally changed the rest of his life, the Detroit Driving Club trophy was offered up for auction at the Park Bernay Galleries in New York City. A private collector bought it, and with that, the punch bowl disappeared into history. And I want to tell you, standing here tonight, it just gives me goosebumps. Now, 10 years later, as we approach the centennial of Ford racing, those omissions bothered us greatly. And so, to have something to use during the 100th anniversary of Ford racing, we asked the guys in special vehicle engineering to spruce up and restore what we thought was a replica of sweepstakes. The car had been taken off display at the Henry Ford and stored in a warehouse since 1987. So a frame-up restoration was obviously in order. And as they began the disassembly process, our engineers noticed a couple of things they found to be quite strange. The first was that this replica was equipped with the Ford vaporizer system. This was a complicated and sensitive fuel delivery system, not the kind of thing you'd stuff under the hood of a car that drove mainly in parades. For that sort of thing, a carburetor would be just fine. The second thing, and the kicker, came as when they took the steering box off the frame, underneath were empty mounting holes and the scuff marks left when an earlier steering box had been removed. Well, we found out, unknowns to many of us, that Henry Ford took off his own steering components and replaced them with Winton's steering assembly that he had purchased before the race, because it was a better steering assembly. And so they proved that the car was actually not a replica at all, but the car that we had staring at us was Henry Ford's original sweepstakes. A little more digging finally proved that my great-grandfather had quietly bought the car back sometime in the 1930s, and stuck the wonderful old race car somewhere into his collection. When I heard about that, it gave me a great deal of hope. we had located the most elusive piece of Ford racing history. If we could do that, frankly, how hard would it be to find a punch bowl? So we quietly put the word out. The operative word is quietly. That the first Ford racing trophy was lost and we desperately wanted it back. Over the last 10 years, we have come up with absolutely nothing. So this year, I'm getting much more serious about this. I'm putting out the word again, hopefully not so quietly, and I'm asking for all of your help. You have readers both in print and online. You talk on radio, you talk on TV shows, you get around, you're influential people. People hang on your every word when you talk about cars or trucks or the auto industry. They listen to most of what you say. I want you to speak up and speak up loudly. Take out your pads, please, ladies and gentlemen. I want you to help us tell the world that Ford has lost its punch bowl. And we want it back. Sit down and write down that assignment. And we don't want it back simply for sentimental reasons. We want it back so we can put it to good use. Last year at the Motorsports Hall of Fame dinner in Detroit, Chip Ganassi delivered one of the most eloquent and moving speeches that I have ever heard. He talked about the need to return relevance to racing, to make the sport more innovative, and to engage young people. The same way so many of us were engaged when we first saw Jackie Stewart or Dan Gurney or Mario Andretti behind the steering wheel. We are not so far from all of that today, and we have the resources to tell the stories. Stories like the NASCAR roof flaps, tire development stories from Goodyear and Firestone, diesel engine development stories from Audi, safer barriers at racetrack from the International Speedway Corporation, the Hans device, NASCAR's car of tomorrow, and the work that our Ford engineers have done with John Force Racing to make NHRA just a little safer. And the great thing about technology is that it gets young people excited about science, engineering, and math, the very areas where our country and our society needs younger minds to get engaged. And after Chip's speech, as Patricia said earlier, Roger Penske and I began talking, and we began to envision an important new project that would re-engage young people with racing. As Patricia and Christian Overland said earlier this evening, the Henry Ford Museum was started by my great-grandfather in 1929. And as I would like to point out as often as I can, it is not the Ford Motor Company Museum. Nor is it a car museum. Nor is it a Hall of Fame. Instead, as they said, it is a living, not-for-profit institution with a mission of learning by doing. As they said, it even has its own public high school. Roger and I had this idea that if we used this exceptional resource as a site for an exhibition that could tell the motor racing story from the point of view of innovation, we should pursue that idea. We reached out and asked Rick Hendrick and Jack Roush for their help, and so the four of us have become co-chairs of the exciting new initiative that Christian talked to you about called Racing in America. And I know many of you have picked up the communications pieces over there, but on your way out, please take one and have a look at it. It is really going to be a wonderful exhibit. We're rolling on the project. We've collected cars that won great championships and that have changed the sport. We're putting together artifacts and stories and oral histories from people like Parnelli Jones and the Wood Brothers, Jim Hall and Dan Gurney. We have a website called racinginamerica.com that offers web-based curriculum materials for grades 3 through 12. It's already being used by hundreds of teachers across the country. That is why we want the punch bowl. We don't want to stick it on some dusty old shelf. We want to put it in that exhibit and use it to help put stars in the eyes of a whole new generation of young people. All right, here's the assignment time. To paraphrase that old saying, there is no such thing as a free dinner speaker. So let me tell you how the members of your fine organization can pay the piper. First, help us find the punch bowl. It's out there somewhere, sitting in some attic or on a dining room table full of potpourri and very ugly ornamental apples. Help us, please, to find our punch bowl. Second, lend us your minds. You've met Patricia Meridian. You met Christian Overland. They can be reached at the Henry Ford. Tell us the stories that you think need to be told in the Racing in America exhibit. And third, put the word out about Racing in America. We need to raise $15 million to make this the multifaceted teaching tool that we know it can be. And even more importantly, we need to tell parents, we need to tell teachers, and we need to tell young people where they can find it. In order for motor racing as a sport to survive, we need to make it relevant to younger people. And we can make it new to generations that were every bit as excited about it as we were when we first witnessed the sport. So on behalf of the team from the Henry Ford, on behalf of Rick Hendrick, Roger Penske, Jack Roush, and myself, I hope that you will join us. Thank you very much. Do you want me to ask questions? Wait, Q&A? 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 So I normally don't like to do this, and please eat your dinner, but I'm happy to answer one question. Yes.
I really thank your father for giving me my very first job in 1962 in England. Without him, I wouldn't be here today. Now, may I tell a very, very brief story about his arrival to Dagenham with his wife, Christine. They were coming to get their new Cortina GT. Cortina GTs were obviously a development of the Cortina, and two huge crates of bigger carburetors arrived. Unfortunately, in those days, the lads had rather huge pockets. By lunchtime, there wasn't one left for your father. Don't ask me how I got the carburetor, but I did get it. We did hand it over to him. We did put it on the boat, and they did sail away to live happily ever after. And thank you so much to him. I don't know how to thank him. He made me
want to send him a note.
I'll find the ball.
Good. Find me the ball. Yes.
Good evening. I'm Trimlet. In the car hobby, the cars of the 60s were really something. Ford put a lot of really neat cars on the racing track so they could put them into limited production. Please tell that history in your museum.
We will.
That would be fantastic.
We're going to tell the history of a lot of very specialized automobiles. So we can't just stick with one kind of racing. So we'll have a representation from drag racing, NASCAR, of the whole potpourri. But somewhere there'll be a little bit of
that would sure be appreciated.
Pony cars.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mark.
Yes.
So how effective is this quite powerful committee of which you are a part going to be able to shake up technology in NASCAR going forward with injection and other more modern technologies?
Yes. Well, no, this committee will do nothing about that. Although I'm sure Mr. Roush and Mr. Hendrick and Mr. Penske have been talking about different fuels for NASCAR and different injection systems and different everything. So they're working hard at it.
Thank you.
Thank you all very much.
Thanks for watching The Auto Channel. For more great coverage of all major motor events, visit theautochannel.com, the internet's most complete and comprehensive automotive resource.